both of the topics for our final two speakers are sort of topics that are unmentionables, right? One of them is end of life, and another is on substance abuse and older adults, and, well, just substance use and older adults. But let's talk about end of life, and let me tell you just a little bit about Redwing. She's the author of Last Acts of Kindness, Lessons for the Living from the Bedside of the Dying, and she's the director of the Palliative Care Program at Seniors at Home, a division of Jewish Family and Children's Services of the San Francisco Bay Area. She's also the founder and steering committee member of the California State University Institute of Palliative Care, and in 2013, she added cancer survivor to her own life experience. Today, she will address a very critical issue, end of life, and the title of her presentation is Be Prepared, Lessons for Living.
I was honored to be asked to speak here today, and I'm thrilled to be part of this. You know, usually when we talk about LGBT aging issues or when we talk about dementia, we still don't discuss the D word. You know, we have come such a long way in our culture, certainly in my lifetime. When I was growing up, the L word was not discussed, no less put on TV with young, beautiful lesbians making love with each other. In my lifetime, we have watched people go from Stonewall to marriage at City Hall. We have gone from our parents having hard times with facts of life discussions to now parents having to come to terms with their children wanting to change gender and live completely different lives from things they were programmed to live. Our world has changed a really lot. Yet somehow, talking about death and dying is still the big taboo. Even though, as the Buddha and many others tell us, birth, suffering, old age, death, these are the things that unite us. These are the things that connect us as human beings. We're all born, and we're all going to die. But we live in a really death-phobic culture. I mean, how many of you have ever purchased a product that said it might be anti-aging? It might help your wrinkles. How many of you have ever put dye on your hair? You know, we live in a world where we are bombarded with anti-aging messages everywhere we go. And if you follow that line of thinking, if we don't have to age, then we don't have to die. It's not true. The world death rate is holding steady at 100%, and none of us are going to get out of here alive. So really, I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about how we actually prepare for this adventure that we're all on, especially those of us who are LGBT, those of us who have dementia. As has been said already today, you know, we have learned so much in our community in the last 30 years, through the AIDS epidemic, through women's cancers epidemics. We know how to show up for each other. We do know how to support each other, how to come together and be family caregivers in that big family picture. And now we have to learn that about dementia, because also, as we've heard today, one out of two of us are going to be there. We could count off right now, but we're not going to do that. So one of the ways we're going to take care of each other is this word called palliative care that keeps getting batted around. In ancient times, palliate meant to cover or to cloak, and then it started to mean to make things better, and that's kind of what we see palliative care as now. Palliative care is a philosophy of care. It's a model of care that very much is about looking at the whole human being. It's about quality of life. It's about all these different levels of suffering that we experience, physical, emotional, spiritual, psychological. And why is it important that we know how to do this? Again, as we've talked about, there are at least 76 million of us getting old rather quickly, every day, a little older. At least 1.5 million, although today it looks like the numbers have gone up already, LGBT elders, and by the year 2030, there are going to be at least 3 to 5 million of us. Palliative care is one of the ways that we're going to help build communities of people to take care of each other. It's really that bridge between acute care when people are sick and in the hospital and hospice care. And palliative care is the one healthcare specialty these days that focuses on communication and dialogue between clinicians and patients, clients, families, loved ones. Some of you may have had an experience with a healthcare professional that didn't have really good communication skills. Has anyone ever had that experience? Palliative care professionals tend to be better trained in these kind of dialogues. So very quickly, I just want to talk a little bit about palliative care and hospice because people always ask the question, you know, what's the difference? And believe me, many, many, many healthcare professionals do not understand the difference between palliative care and hospice. So we have to educate them once again. So hospice, for our terms today, is a medical model pretty much defined by Medicare that says that if a doctor can say that likely your disease is going to progress in a normal way, you will likely have 6 months or less to live, with a caveat being that you're also going to forgo curative treatment, which really applies a lot in the cancer community because you have to stop doing chemotherapy, radiation, clinical trials in order to get on hospice. This is a big issue governmentally, politically, medically, socially right now because we're really trying to change that so that people who are clearly at the end of life but want to still pursue some kind of treatment could also have hospice. But right now, this is kind of where it stands. Palliative care, on the other hand, does not have this six-month definition. It really has the ability to help people at any stage of an illness, from diagnosis all the way to the end of life. And there have been, again, many studies showing that when people have palliative care along with whatever treatment they're getting, they live higher quality of life and they tend to live longer lives. Clearly, people who have dementia are suffering on all of these levels for a very long time, so why not have palliative care be part of the way to help them? Actually, I'm going to skip this slide because there are lots and lots of myths and misunderstandings about hospice, but that's not really what I want to focus on. This slide is in your packet. Really mostly just to say that people are so afraid of hospice. They're really afraid that, oh no, I'm not going to make this referral to hospice because that means the person's going to die tomorrow. Or I don't want my partner going on hospice because, you know, everybody on hospice just dies right away. Partly why we think that is because people don't get admitted to hospice in a timely manner. They wait until the last week or the last 2 weeks or the last 3 days of life. And they're admitted to hospice because they are dying. They don't die because they were admitted to hospice. And so there are a lot of myths about hospice that we have to confront. And again, similarities between hospice and palliative care, mostly what I really hope you take away is that hospice always includes palliative care. Hospice is also about taking care of the whole person, all those levels of suffering. Palliative care is a philosophy as well as a modality of care. But palliative care doesn't always include hospice, doesn't always have to include hospice. Both of them use interdisciplinary teams. Someone talked about that earlier today, this idea that there's a team taking care of you, not one person. And yes, that team includes doctors, nurses, social workers, chaplains, often volunteers. It's really important that it's a whole team because there might be one person on the team who's appropriate at one point in this journey and another person at another time. The biggest challenge, of course, is where do you get palliative care? Unfortunately, Every hospital in the Bay Area has a palliative care team. We've gone from, in the year 2000, 500 palliative care teams in hospitals nationwide to now we have 2,000. Most major hospitals have a palliative care team. What people don't know is that you can ask to see that team. You need to get a referral, but you can say, there's a lot of confusion going on with my loved one's care. I really need somebody to talk to who's going to sort of have a better communication with me about it, talk about what the options are, talk about are we ready for end of life. That's where you call in the palliative care team. The huge, huge, huge need right now is for more community-based palliative care, because we know that where you really need this kind of help is not when you're in the hospital, but when you're at home outside of the hospital. The program that we run at Jewish Family and Children's Services is really one of the only community-based palliative care teams in the country where you can have a palliative care consult. We are an interdisciplinary team. We collaborate with all of the hospices, the palliative care inpatient teams, but again, this is something that people need to know about, people need to talk about, because we understand now that it's consumers demanding this kind of care, this level of care, that's going to change it. So palliative care in people with dementia. As we said, we know that people with dementia are suffering on many, many levels. And this need for spiritual care, as well as all the others, is so critical. You know, there's a favorite quote of mine that says, we are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We're spiritual beings having a human experience. So whether we have dementia, or whether we have cancer, or whether we have whatever we have, we're still a spiritual being. And we can relate to that spiritual part of each of our beings. I had a dear friend some years ago whose father had very advanced Alzheimer's, and they lived in Florida, my friend invited her parents to come for the Jewish holidays of Passover and spend with her lesbian community. So they came out here to California, and everybody was a little nervous. You know, her mother was used to feeding her father, spoon-feeding him. Was he going to be comfortable? Was he going to know where he was? He was going to be the only man in this whole room of lesbians. Like, how is that going to play out? So the truth is, they got there, the ritual starts, the candles get lit, the songs and prayers begin. And he just sits up straight, looks around the room, and starts singing the prayers. Because his spiritual being is still intact. And those prayers and those rituals were very much a part of who he is that was not going to go away. Caregivers and family members, as we've talked about, need huge, huge amount of support, and much more support than we ever give them. And that is really, you know, part of the crux of what needs to happen and what we're here to talk about today. And as we've also talked about, a lot of mainstream healthcare providers don't account for the unique realities of us, of the LGBT community as we age, which does leave us at even higher risk for isolation, for discrimination, for neglect. The stats tell us we're 3 to 4 times more likely to not have children, so there's not necessarily family who are going to show up. Not that having children always means they're going to come take care of you, but, you know, you maybe have a little bit more of a chance. So in order to help take care of each other, palliative care is also about advanced care planning. Advanced care planning is critical. And what's really critical is that we need to be really, really specific in our advanced directives for healthcare. Advanced directives, power of attorney for healthcare, same thing. Ideally, okay, how many people in this room have an advanced directive for healthcare completed? Oh, we are an evolved group here. Okay. That's good. Everybody else who did not raise their hand is gonna do that in the next week, I'm sure. Really, when you're 18, you're supposed to do an advanced directive for healthcare because, you know, none of us know how long our ticket is to be on this earth. We have this fantasy these days, because people are living longer, that we're all going to be the one to live to 95, be absolutely healthy, not have any disease, and die in our sleep. Not going to happen. So Having these conversations about end-of-life wishes before a diagnosis of dementia, before a diagnosis really of any serious illness, or at very early stages, is absolutely critical. Who are going to be the decision makers? Who are the people who knew this person, who understands their values? Those are the people who you want making decisions for you. I had another dear friend who had a stroke at age 52 and was flown down here to Stanford Hospital from up in the country in Mendocino. And her lover jumped in the car and came down to Stanford, and her circle of friends followed. But she didn't have anything in writing about her wishes. She was 52. She didn't think that was her. And so, of course, who was called to make decisions? Her brother, who lived in Arizona, who she hadn't seen in many, many years. Now, the good part of this story is that when he showed up, he at least recognized that he was not really the one capable of making these decisions. He understood that she had been a lesbian for her whole life, that these were the people who knew her best, and that really he needed to have the conversation with the healthcare team to make sure they understood who the people were who knew her. But it's not always that best case scenario. People show up from out of town who haven't seen you or known you or understood you for a long time. And if you don't have anyone legally written down and decided to be the person to make decisions for you, sometimes people who are then in that place of power are not the people you want there. Having the conversation, though, is really the most important with all of your friends, with all of your family, with all of the people who might be there to take care of you. So what are some other things to consider? Someone talked a little bit about neuropsych evaluations as early as possible. I heard a neuropsychologist a few years ago who talked about, of course, the fact that dementia is most of the time not diagnosed till way too late. And what if we all had a baseline neuropsych evaluation at 60? Because neuropsych evaluations aren't about comparing me to you, comparing apples to oranges. It's about comparing me to me. What could I do when I was 50? What can I do when I'm 70? We do baseline mammograms. We do baseline prostate antigen tests. This is a disease that's going to hit half of us. Why not do baseline neuropsych evaluations? Again, because if someone does not have capacity anymore to make decisions for themselves, then we're talking about conservatorship. We're talking about someone really having to take complete control of your life for you, which is another level of scary for people. Big lesson I learned a couple of years ago with an older lesbian couple that we were caring for in an assisted living facility. She had advancing dementia. She and her partner had been together for 40 years. Her partner came and visited her every single day in the assisted living. When this woman had early stage dementia, she gave her power of attorney for healthcare to her partner, but gave her power of attorney for finance to her two sons who lived in Los Angeles. Well, let me tell you, the fights that happened constantly, because for one thing, the sons were really not happy about their mother's choice of partner, and they had really different ideas about what was the right way to use her finances. Her partner really felt like she needed 24/7 one-on-one care along with assisted living to get the best quality of life she could. Her sons felt like that wasn't what they wanted to spend the money on for whatever reasons. It was a really, really, really challenging situation. And the situation progressed because she really got weaker and weaker and weaker. And yet she was living in a situation where she was being force-fed. She was being taken to the dining room, food spooned into her mouth. And finally, we had one of many, many family meetings where actually the sons and the partner got to the same page, because one of the sons said, you know, my mom was an athlete. She was really alive. She loved to hike. Honestly, the way she would have wanted to die would have been to be in Yosemite, to walk off the path, to go out into the woods, and to die like an animal. She would not want to be in a situation, and this is a challenge because often with dementia, it's not like we're on machines. Life support isn't necessarily a ventilator or IVs, but it's continuing to keep people alive in whatever ways we can, and feeding is one of those. And finally, because this woman could barely walk, could barely move, could barely get out of bed, they all decided that she would actually be better off in residential hospice than in assisted living, because the focus of residential hospice is comfort and quality of life. So we were able to move her to a residential hospice where she got the right care that she needed, and she died within 2 weeks. You know, people say, oh, well, I'm just going to move to Oregon. Well, the truth is, once you have a dementia diagnosis, you can't just necessarily get up and drive your car to Oregon. You know, thinking about when you write your advance directive, what kind of treatments do you want? What kind of treatments don't you want? If there are comorbidities, if you have cancer and dementia, if you have heart disease, lung disease, and dementia, then does it make sense to give people antibiotics at the end of life in order to just bring them back to a level of suffering that maybe is still really hard? These are all really hard questions. Do we put feeding tubes into people who can't swallow? Do we put feeding tubes in with the idea that then they're going to be in a nursing home and where the culture around stopping feeding tubes is really challenging? There's this whole new idea about voluntarily stopping eating and drinking. There was an article in the New York Times recently. A lawyer in Boston had written up his advance directive, stating very clearly that if he had dementia, he wanted his agents, his people, to stop feeding him. Oddly enough, I have the same thing in my advance directive that says, if I don't recognize my loved ones, if I can't take care of myself, I want you to stop feeding me. As much as I love life, as much as I love food, even the coffee ice cream, I want you to just give me a tiny, tiny bit, but not really feed me, because I don't really want to spend my resources that way. But we all have different choices about that. What's important is that we think about our choices now while we have capacity. Think about what quality of life means to us, and tell our people what that means. When is hospice appropriate? That's going to be a conversation that you continue to have with your healthcare providers, and hopefully they understand who you are as an LGBT person and as someone with dementia, which is why you have to build trust over years with your healthcare providers. Yes, people get to signs and symptoms of end-stage dementia, but In the old days, you could be admitted to hospice with a diagnosis called failure to thrive. That doesn't really happen anymore. I had a client with Parkinson's disease and dementia, and his partner had been taking care of him 24/7 for years and didn't really see how much of a decline he was in. I showed up to evaluate them and thought, oh my gosh, this man is really towards the end of life. And I called his neurologist, and I said, what about a hospice consult? And the neurologist said, really read me through IDECT. He's nowhere near the end of life. He's my prize patient. He's doing fine. A week later, he had a horrible fall. He ended up in the hospital. We had a palliative care consultation in the hospital. He then went to coming home hospice and died a week later. So his neurologist was a little surprised that he was really at the end of life. We have to think about the resources that we need to take care of each other at the end of life. I urge you, don't promise your partner or anyone else that you will never, ever put them in a facility, because we can't always keep that promise, and then we just end up feeling guilty. When you do have to use facilities, make sure they have a hospice waiver. Make sure they can take care of your loved one until the end of life. Ask the people philosophical questions before you admit your loved one to that facility. How do they feel about feeding tubes? How do they feel about discontinuing medications? How do they feel about taking care of people at the end of life? And what are their policies about LGBT seniors? Have they had in-services? Has Michelle come to see them? And if not, offer to do those in-services, create them. We have to be prepared. You know, none of us had a class in high school or college that was Death and Dying 101. So pretty much when people learn about death and dying is when they're at the bedsides of somebody that they care about. And there's a lot of ways that we can understand this before we get there. But we have to be willing to think about it and talk about it. Anticipatory grief, I'm rushing through these last couple of slides, is just something I want to mention because anyone in this audience who has taken care of someone with dementia knows that your grief starts as soon as that diagnosis happens because you lose the person who you loved in some ways from the beginning. And that grief can go through all the ways that Elizabeth Kubler-Ross talked about grief: anger, depression, bargaining, denial, acceptance. We go round and round with that. But grief lives with us, and it causes guilt, and it causes fatigue, and it causes illness in the caregivers. So what can you do is ask for help when you're the caregiver. At Seniors at Home, we have a futures program where you can sign up for care even if you don't need it, so that you just know that when you do need care, you've got someone to call. And clearly, there's Family Caregiver Alliance. Open House has tons of support groups. The Alzheimer's Association. There are online support groups. There are a lot of things we can do to prevent burnout. But when you're caring for people at the end of life, it is a really hard thing to do. And we need more and more tools. There's a great deck of cards. We have some out at our table called Go Wish. It's a great tool to have a conversation with someone about their end-of-life wishes. There's also one specifically for people with dementia. It's called the My Way cards that you can find online. There are books. There's a website that's called Prepare. That's a low literacy website for advanced directives done by Rebecca Sidori, a palliative care doc here at San Francisco General. There are lots of tools out there. One of the ones I use when I teach volunteers is called Sit, Listen, and Breathe, because that's what we can do. And I would love you to just stand up for 1 second, actually for 30 seconds. Because one of the things we can do to take care of ourselves, as we talked about, there's meditation, there's just being quiet, there's taking a deep breath. This is called a loving kindness meditation for ourselves as professional and family caregivers. May I offer my care and presence unconditionally, knowing that it may be met by gratitude, by indifference, by anger, or by anguish. May I find the inner resources to truly be able to give. May I remain at peace and let go of my expectations of this situation. May this experience help me open to the true nature of life, which is impermanence. May I see my own limits compassionately, just as I view the suffering of those I love. And may I and all beings live and die at ease and in peace. I want to end with one last poem that says, "How did the rose ever know? Ever open its heart and give the world all its beauty. It felt the encouragement of light against its being. Otherwise, we all remain too frightened." We all have the tools to encourage light. We all carry compassion and love in our hearts, in our pockets. It's probably the most important tool you have in dealing with dementia and in dealing with end of people at the end of life, ourselves, our loved ones, our families. Thank you for carrying these tools around and for being here today to share it with us.
Just a minute or two for questions. Are there any in the audience? Would people, if you've written any down, people can collect those. And are there any hands? Anybody would like to stand up and share a question?
What kind of training is involved with being a palliative care worker?
The question is, what kind of training is involved in being a palliative care worker? all levels of training in terms, depending on what profession you're in. You know, there are specific coursework for doctors, nurses, social workers, chaplains. And then there's volunteer training, which we do at our agency, similar to hospice volunteer training. But honestly, palliative care training is about looking at our own understanding of life and death, being aware in our own beings that we are impermanent. Because if you haven't ever confronted those issues and that possibility in yourself, how are you going to help somebody else who's dying?
On the voluntary no food, no water directive, has that been implemented anywhere successfully? I read that same article you did, and I think, if I remember, the care providers were very uneasy with it, because when the person had dementia, they say, oh yeah, I'm hungry, I want some food, even though prior to dementia they'd said they didn't want any of that.
Right. I think this is going to be one of the huge issues of our time, because I think there are a lot of us who feel that way and are going to be writing it down. And, you know, I think this is going to end up probably in the courts and in various other places, but all the more reason to have the conversation with the people around you so that your wishes can be carried out without other people intervening. But I do think it's going to be a big controversy for a long time. You know, we so believe that food is love and food is life, and that stopping feeding people is not the right thing to do. And yet, you know, before we had technology and ventilators and all the medical, technical life support that we have, people stopped eating at the end of their lives and they died. Allowing natural death, A-N-D, was what happened for most of, you know, the last hundreds of years. So, you know, really the intervention of keeping people alive is the challenge.
I think when somebody says they want to eat and they have dementia, they have an advanced care directive, that you can also just give them something tiny to eat.
Absolutely.
And they have it, and it's in the moment. I think that if
Absolutely.
Someone has a healthcare directive, we also need to remember that that was written then. It doesn't mean you don't honor their wishes, but in the moment they might like just a bite. Of something, because it takes care of some other piece that's going on with them.
Exactly. Exactly. And I think that's probably what's going to happen more and more.
Thank you so much, Redwing. Very